Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. Welcome to another episode of Brains Matter. I'm currently sitting in the Department of Zoology at the University of Melbourne. It's a lovely sunny day, and as many of you have heard over the past year and a half or so, Brains Matter has been doing a series on the conservation and the plight of the Asian elephant, and I've previously interviewed Professor Roger Short. I've also interviewed Dr. Roger Rasool about the elephant sounds, and also Evan Bittner quite recently. And right in front of me I have Professor Short and Evan Bittner with me, so we've got a two-for-one today. So welcome to the show once again, gentlemen.
Very nice to be here, because I think your podcast is just amazing, the interest it's generating. And it's just the audience that we don't really normally touch in academia. And one or two of the things that might interest your listeners, we had a meeting in Melbourne in, I think it was November, of school principals from 50 of the leading Victorian schools. And Evan and I gave them a talk on elephant vocalizations, and Roger Rasool came along, and we thought, wouldn't it be exciting if we could shake 50 school principals with elephant infrasound? And they were extremely interested in the talks we gave, and I think they're going to want to get us to go and give talks in their schools, and that's an amazing audience to motivate. And I think
absolutely,
to be able to talk to school kids about elephants would be fabulous. So that's something that may come out of our November meeting, and we'll make sure that we connect you to the list of the school principals so that you can actually contact them.
And that'll be great.
Listen to the podcast. So that's number one. Number two is that we're hoping, and I've got to be a bit sort of vague about it because it's not finally fixed, but we've had a request from a very senior Sri Lankan vet in Peridinia in Sri Lanka, where I've spent some time working on elephants, who wants to come and spend 4 months with us here. And he's applied for this senior Australian government fellowship, which we hope he'll get. We should know any day now. And if he does, that will give us an amazing in to elephants throughout the whole of Sri Lanka, where we'd love to have some projects going, because the Sri Lankan mahouts are famous for being really knowledgeable about the elephants they've been working with for the last 1,000 years or so.
Yep, because in the previous interviews, you and I have talked about India, and Evan and I spoke about Laos quite a fair bit. So this would be a great addition to it as well.
A sort of an expansion of it. And then the final thing, sort of really over to Evan, because he's off on Good Friday, which we hope will be a really good Friday, to Laos, to look at the elephants there.
Okay, so Evan, did you want to speak a little bit about that trip and what you're intending on doing?
Basically, it's unfortunately with academic commitments I can't go for too long, but I've get 10 days over there, and I've got a few meetings set up with the Elephant Asia people again to talk about what I talked about with you last time, which is the setting up of the Never Forget Elephants charity. And we're working on trying to set up three major collaborative projects, which we've kind of conceived over here in Melbourne, and are trying to take over to Elephant Asia in Laos so that we can put them into place with their cooperation. Because as I was saying to you last time when you interviewed me, what we really want to do is not just go over there and throw money around, but actually really work with the people on the ground there. So we've actually used a lot of their current ideas that they have, and thought of ways in which we could use the resources we have over here in Australia to actually help those projects and enhance them somewhat. So a lot of that is kind of in really early stages, so not sure how it'll go so far, but they've been really interested so far in what we've had to say. And so the major reason of my trip is to go over there, but also I'm going to try to head up north and get just in amongst the villages up there and the mahouts. And just it's amazing how much you can learn just from talking to people. I mean, me and Roger have Roger has committed a major part of his life to learning everything he possibly can about elephants, and I've started that journey for myself. But I mean, we can't even touch on the knowledge that these people have. Just for hundreds of generations, these people have just lived with elephants their entire lives, which we touched upon a little bit, but it really is amazing that just the intimate knowledge. And one of the things that we really kind of, it's probably one of the first things that we thought of really doing was trying to tap into that knowledge and get past the language barrier and actually just sitting down and listening to these people and what they have to say is something you can really learn a lot. And that's one of the major reasons that an organisation like Elephant Age is so great for us, because that can remove that language barrier and really set up some exciting prospects for us. So.
And we've got some global warming good news.
Oh, it's about time we got some good news.
If it's true that the Himalayan glaciers are not melting as fast as we feared from the original IPCC report,
mm-hmm.
then that means that those two great rivers, the Salween and the Mekong, which are vital for the survival of Thailand and Laos, and particularly vital for the survival of the Asian elephant,
mm-hmm.
They're going to keep running for longer than we had feared, which is wonderful. And I think it's one of the things that you can spread the news about when you go to Laos. Do you say Lao or Laos? I'm never quite sure.
I've been saying Laos, but Evan has been saying Laos. So
I think it's really just a dialect thing.
Yes,
I don't think either it's wrong or right. And and even talking to people over there, I think the French say Lao and the locals say Laos. So it's one of those things that both are right, I'm pretty sure.
For your listeners, L-A-O-S is what we're talking about.
So Southeastern Asia, for those people who want to look up a map right now.
And right next door to Thailand.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So, that's very exciting if there's going to be water still running in the major rivers that feed the forests.
But that's not to say there is no issue there at all. We still need to be concerned about it. It's just we have longer to
play
with.
But we've got a bit longer.
Mm-hmm. I think the best thing is that it gives us an opportunity to... It's not a lost cause now. It means it's even more reason we need to work harder, because now it's actually a realistic possibility that we could save this. And I think that people really need to start working towards thinking of this as important as it is. And a lot of people still to this day don't really appreciate how big of a problem we have on our hands. So.
Mm-hmm. Well, there are still politicians who doubt all sorts of science, no matter where it's coming from. Don't they?
Yeah.
I want to get on to the recent birth of the elephant at Taronga Zoo up in Sydney. And Roger, you just come from a meeting with Thomas Hildebrand about that.
Yes. So Thomas Hildebrand and his two colleagues flew out from Berlin, and they are the world's experts on elephant artificial insemination and management of pregnancies and management of labour. When I say they're the world's experts, they're the only people who've really specialised in this, and they are amazing in what they've been able to do. And Thomas was telling me over drinks on Friday evening last week just how depressing it was, because they saw this female in Taronga Zoo going into labour unquestionably, and she passed some of the waters, the amnion looked as if it broke, and they were expecting there would be a birth immediately, but nothing happened and nothing happened and nothing happened. And Thomas was able to give an injection into the fetus, which he thinks was probably critical. And one night when they had all felt that there was no hope, because there were no signs of fetal movement that anyone could detect, so they thought, well, maybe the fetus was dead, although they didn't really know. And the next morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, here's this baby born. And it was pretty exhausted. It couldn't stand up. And so they had to collect colostrum, the sort of first milk from the mother, and stomach tube the baby and give it this life-giving milk, which was probably the best thing they could possibly have done. And now anyone going to Sydney Zoo will see a very robust, young, stroppy elephant that's already been jumping into the pool, and the keeper got very worried. And all the other elephants sort of jumped into the pool to help get the baby out.
Mm-hmm.
And you might have seen some of this on television on Channel 10, which I didn't see it actually. But from what we know about the aquatic ancestry of the elephant, probably that baby was fine,
mm-hmm.
because they've already learnt to use their trunk as a snorkel.
Mm-hmm.
I think, you know, probably they've learnt inside the womb, actually. And so they just love water from the day of birth.
And another note on that is with a lot of kind of, with the kind of huge amount of media coverage we've had with the recent births, we've had two in Taronga now successful and one in Melbourne, mm-hmm. with another one on the way in September. And despite the kind of general jubilation, there has been a little bit of grumbling about from welfare groups about how, you know, it's cruel again to have elephants in captivity, and that a lot of people are upset again that with these births it's just more elephants. But when you think of just the social structure of an elephant herd and how they create, the whole purpose of a female herd is to reproduce,
mm-hmm.
and those young calves, just the enrichment that you would get from having a young calf in a herd of females is just, you could not possibly quantify what that would mean. I mean, that gives
that's what they exist to
those, do. That gives those elephants a purpose in life now, that they and I think it's the best possible thing that they could do for them is to get them reproducing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, again, with that pool example, it just reinforced that even more so, that you saw the baby fall in and immediately every single elephant, even the other little young calf, ran into that pool, and the mother just basically picked him up and took him out of the water, and all the aunts were standing there, and they're not even related, and that just shows how much that they've started to function, and all of them really care about each other, and it really does bring them closer and give them a purpose in life. And I'm personally, I just think that's the best possible thing that they could do for those elephants. I mean, I suppose what I think it's exactly the opposite of what I was saying. I think it would be cruel to keep them in captivity and not let them reproduce, because, like I said, that's their whole purpose, and that's what they're basically driven in life to do, is that matriarchal behaviour, and it's really, really good for them, so it's good to see.
I'm sure a lot of our humans can relate to that as well. If you're in a menial job and you feel as though you have no purpose, you get bored quite easily, and you wonder what you're doing there, and as soon as you put into a role where they're using some of your skills or knowledge and you feel useful, it suddenly becomes enjoyable, and it changes the whole outlook of what you're doing.
Yeah. It is amazing to see a matriarchal society like that, where males are excluded, really. The bulls are pushed out, and you don't see an adult bull unless he comes in to join the herd when there's a female in heat, when he will mate with her. And the females will only mate once every 4 years, and mating takes about 1 minute. So you only need a bull 1 minute every 4 years, and the rest of the time get rid of him, because he's just a competitor for food.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a mother and calf society, which is absolutely beautiful to watch.
Mm.
And any of the people who've been opposing the breeding of elephants in captivity just doesn't understand elephants. And I think all the animal liberationists who've been up in arms about the very fact that we've got elephants and that we're breeding them should just go and look at that mother-calf interaction and realize, as Evan says, that this is what is fulfillment for all those elephants, that they've got a natural life in the zoo.
And another really kind of beautiful thing about the matriarchal society is that it's just another example of something in common that elephants have with humans, is that with a female will stay in a herd long after her reproductive life is finished,
mm-hmm.
which happens with people. We have grandmothers, mothers who have no real reproductive value to society, but we still have that kind of connection with them. And in a lot of animal species, as soon as an animal is no longer reproductively active, it's gone from the population. Whereas with elephants, you see this with the grandmothers and mothers and aunts and uncles, not so much uncles, sorry. they all have this role in mothering. It's not just a mother and its calf; it's a family situation.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's just another way that we can kind of connect with elephants in a way we can't connect with other animals.
And you were explaining in the last interview series one of the ways we can align the breeding in captivity and the wild the wilderness nature of the elephants is to have these breeding parks backing onto national parks.
Mm-hmm.
And so is that something that's you're looking at expanding with this new charity as well?
Oh, absolutely. And if we had any, I know the Elephant Asia one is still, I haven't actually heard much about it yet, but I know it's still in the plans, and any opportunity we could have to set up that kind of thing, which is just, that's exactly what we need, is that kind of sanctuary where we're breeding elephants in as natural environment as we possibly can.
Mm-hmm.
That said, there's also, it's not a viable thing for places like Australia and things, and there's been a lot of talk about moving the elephants from Melbourne Zoo into Werribee Zoo.
Mm-hmm.
But again, that is
And for the listeners out there, Werribee Zoo is an open plains zoo.
Yeah, exactly. And this is just a really uneducated kind of decision that would be made, because an Asian elephant does not like an open plain at all. They're deep forest animals. They need a lot of space, but they don't like open space. They like to kind of be enclosed and be able to go in and out. They still need a lot of space, but if you put them in a paddock, they would sit in a corner with each other and it would not be a beneficial thing for them. So,
mm-hmm.
Again, the real problem is that these are really complicated animals, and you need people who know what they're doing making the decisions on them. So,
almost need elephant psychologists, really, don't we?
But one of the interesting things, if you look at Asian and African elephants, what's the big difference? The size of the ears.
Mm-hmm.
So African elephants have got very big ears, and Asian elephants, very small ears. And why is that? Well, elephants have no sweat glands mm-hmm. anywhere in the body. So how do they keep cool? They've got a mechanism at the back of the ear where if they flap the ear, it's got a lot of blood vessels close to the surface, and they can get a sort of evaporative cooling,
okay.
even though there's no sweat there.
Mm-hmm.
So you watch elephants in really hot weather, and you can tell the temperature of the day by how frequently they're flapping their ears. And the African elephant has learned to come out into the open savanna and graze, really, because there's nothing to browse because there are no trees. But it gets hot in the process, so it's developed these great big ears. Whereas the Asian elephant, it really is, as Evan says, a forest animal,
mm-hmm.
which is why its ears are much smaller, and it wants to be protected from direct rays of the sun and from heating. So the sort of environment that they're in Melbourne Zoo is really very good for them,
mm-hmm.
and put them out into an open plain like Werribee, an African elephant might survive there, but that's not what Asian elephants were designed for.
And also with the elephants in captivity, I guess a lot of them are used to the environment they're in now, so if we pulled them out and threw them into a quote-unquote wilder environment,
exactly.
they may not cope that well.
And that's something that's in captive animal management with any animal, a change in environment is something that really is a large stress on them.
Mm-hmm.
And even when you're moving them from, for example, if you talk about with Bong Su and Mekapa, the original two elephants from Melbourne Zoo that have been there since the over 35 years now, and they moved from the old exhibit, which was very bad, into this new exhibit, which is quite modern and has a lot more enrichment for them, and they still initially was they had a lot of stress involved with that, because it's just different and it's a change for them, and it is hard to cope. I mean anyone who's moved house can kind of sympathize with it. There is a lot of frustration involved, and it takes a lot for an animal to adjust to its settings, especially if it's lived in an enclosure for most of its life.
Mm.
And then you move it, even if it's to something better, you will have this initial period of stress. So what you want to do is actually minimise the amount of movement you do for an animal as much as you can. And that doesn't only apply to elephants, that applies to anything in captive animal management. So,
well, thanks to you and your podcast. It was listened to by an accountant, Glenn Antonovich, who came to see us and said, hey, fascinated to hear about the elephants. Could he give us his services for free,
mm-hmm.
To help in any way? And we said, well, it would be wonderful if we could set up a charity for elephants here in Australia. And he said, what would you call it? So we sort of scratched our head a bit and said, well, why don't we call it Never Forget Elephants?
So a bit of a play on elephants never forget.
And Glenn said, oh, that would be fantastic. I'll go into the details of setting up a charity. Mm-hmm. So it's not quite established yet, but it will be in the very near future.
Mm-hmm.
And we hope that we could use that as another source of funding to see if we can help conserve elephants in their natural habitat in the wild, which mm-hmm. must be our first priority. And we would like to link ourselves very closely to the wonderful work that Elephant Asia is already doing in Laos, and hopefully link ourselves with what's going on in Sri Lanka,
mm-hmm.
and maybe attract some money from Australian audiences who would really like to put their money where their mouth is and save Asian elephants in their natural habitat in the wild, and see that the 30,000 Asian elephants which are left, which is the total number in the world, let's see that they're there by the end of this century.
That'd be fantastic. And once that charity is established, I'll put all the details up on the website. So for those people who are listening and you want to learn more about it, just keep an eye on the website, and as details come to hand, I'll put them up. So Roger and Evan, I'd like to thank you both for appearing on the show once again today. It's been a pleasure to have you on.
Yeah, pleasure.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the BrainsMatter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glenn Gertz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.